All right. So thank you for coming. It's great to see you guys. I know this is kind of getting into harvest and then crush and then all that stuff, but hopefully, since it's during lunch, you can just kind of listen to us like a podcast and hopefully chime in if you have any questions. So before I get started, this thing will actually go. There we go. CSU is an equal opportunity access, non-discrimination. So if you have any issues or in the future you need to access us, please let me know so I can actually make sure we have some accommodations for you. But some just general etiquette for our little Zoom adventure here. Cameras on is great. It does kind of feel like we're doing a radio show here into the great emptiness when we have no faces that we can look at. I do understand if you're in a location where internet is questionable and you can't turn it on, so bandwidth can be an issue, but if you would like to, please turn on your cameras. We'd love to see your happy faces. Please keep your mics off until the end of the session, just because then we don't have to worry about feedback or anything like that. We can take questions all throughout the entire presentation through the chat box. I'm actually just going to send a message through it right now, so you can see where that chat box is. Feel free to drop questions in there all throughout the talk. If we don't answer them immediately, I'll make sure that those will be the priority once we get towards the end of the presentation. So don't worry, we'll get to it, or it might be answered in the next slide. So don't worry about that. All right, today's speaker is John Kallenbach. He is from the actual Colorado Department of Agriculture, and I'll actually let him do quite a bit of the explanation about the insectary and what their control programs are and all of that, since he's going to be able to do it a little bit better than me. But he is a graduate of the University of Wyoming, and he's also from Wyoming, so he's kind of Colorado adjacent, and he's been around the area for quite a while and has been in Colorado for over 16 years. And for those 16 years, he's been working with the Colorado Department of Agriculture. But the last 10 is actually when he started working with the biocontrol program with the insectary. So they do a wide range of things, including both insect and weed control. So he's going to be able to talk a little bit about a variety of different things that the insectary is working on. So with that being said, I'm going to stop sharing my screen and turn it over to John.
Thank you very much. Let me get this going. How's that look?
Perfect.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you very
Looks
much for the
great.
invite. Appreciate that. I'm going to give a little bit of background about the insectary, define what biological control is, talk about what we do as the insectary and what's available for potentially for you to use, and then if we get a little time at the end, I've got a little bit I put in here that's not weed biocontrol, but may be of interest to you, and that would be Japanese beetle biocontrol. I am with the Colorado Department of Agriculture. We have di eight different divisions within CDA. Do a lot of consumer advocacy, consumer support stuff. I am in the conservation biocontrol program. Is in the conservation services. Which is got also noxious weeds, weed-free forage, ag water quality. We have an acre three energy program, some other stuff. The Palisade Insectary, which you may be familiar with, started over in Palisade back in the 1940s. Peach growers were it was peaches were a burgeoning industry then, and they were having problems with the peach moth, Graphelita molesta, and they figured out a biocontrol for it. So the insectary was started in a little tiny house there, and it was originally dubbed the Bug House. And then it moved to the current facility in 1992. So this is the 77th year of the insectary, started in 1945. Basically, that with through the success of that, they built off that biocontrol program and expanded to other things. And so currently we have about 23 different agents, we call them, that we work with to control 15 different pests and weeds. We like to consider ourselves a partner in pest management. We like to work with you and whatever your pest management goals are and see if we can get biocontrol to fit into your management goals. Like I said, there's been some growth, and over the history of the insectary, we've had 21 different noxious weed programs and 13 different programs to control insect pests. And this is kind of, I just had, this is just for fun. This is for any entomologists out there, insect people that want to see. These are the types of agents that we've had over the years. You can see almost more than half of them have been beetles, quite a number of wasps we've worked with, flies and moths. Those make the bulk of the agents we've used for biocontrol. And then we've got a few mites, pathogens, one true bug, and a nematode in the past. So there's a couple of our insect agents. I have a coworker that actually called our insects that we work with our coworkers. I like that. We do want them to work for us, and I'll kind of explain how that works. So our mission for the CDA is to provide biocontrol agents. So we work with new agents. We do research on those. They're for free. We get them. We usually get them from the U.S. Department of Agriculture. We have research projects where we do monitoring, non-target monitoring. We do vegetative monitoring. We do to see the effects or not, or potentially maybe there's no effect for things. Getting them established, how to work with them. Sometimes we have to rear them at the insectary and release them. We have to kind of learn about their life cycle. There's a lot of things that we have to learn once they get to Colorado. And then our well-established agents, which are mostly what I'm going to talk about today, we have a request a bug program. So any Colorado landowner can buy insects from us for a nominal fee. We don't make money on it. It barely covers our expenses, but it is a way for us to get our agents disseminated. So like I said, we do a lot of monitoring of our introductions. And then this, as along with a lot of tours, we give a lot of tours of the insectary if you're ever interested in that. Usually you can get, if you're involved in any groups, sometimes groups have tours of the insectary. We love to talk about what we do and have people come by and visit. I do a lot of talks as well, online talks and in-person talks. And then I've done a few talks with schools and stuff too. So what is biocontrol? Well, it's a safe, sustainable, inexpensive way to reduce pests. It's ecologically based. It is suppression of pests, not eradication. It does take some time to work. It's not fast acting like an herbicide would be. We like to be, like I said, a partner in pest management, and it really depends on what your pest management goals are. I've got that little chart on there. There's other types of control methods, which I'm sure you're familiar with. There's chemical, there's cultural, the way you do things. Mechanical could be plowing or weeding or hoeing. Physical barriers you could put up for pests, and then biological control. So these are the sort of the integrated methods to control things, pests. I would say for weeds, prevention is probably your biggest, best method. Prevention before things ever get there, and then reducing disturbance also is really any disturbed ground. Weeds really like to take hold of any disturbed ground. So we use natural enemies to control pests. That can include different types of predators or parasites against or pathogens against arthropod pests, so other insect pests, and then we also use insect herbivores and pathogens against plants. There are a few different types of biological control. Inundative, which is where you would have lots of, you'd mass rear lots of insects and then inundate your crop with them so that they would control your pest. Augmentative would be the same, kind of similar. You'd raise some and add to a population, augment the population that's already out there. There is a thing called conservation biological control. In terms of you would conserve your natural enemies, so that's being very careful how you spray pesticides so that they're not affecting beneficial insects, planting or cultivating habitat, hedgerows, and things like that, where your agents can find refuge and come be there for your pests. And then there's classical biocontrol, and that's what mostly the insectary works on. And that is the introduction of foreign agents to control foreign pests. So most of our noxious weeds in the state are from other overseas, and they're brought over and reintroduced with their pest, their host here. It's basically the idea that one of the reasons why things are invasive or pestilent in the US is because they've escaped natural controls, this top-down control of something eating them. And so we go and reintroduce the pest to its natural enemy with the idea that it'll make it expend some resources, have to deal with herbivory. It allows other things to grow instead, outcompete it, and things like that. And the idea, like I said, is not to eradicate, but to bring the pest populations down to some lower economic or environmental threshold. And this is sort of a graph showing sort of the pest population is very high, and then you introduce a natural enemy, and over time, this is the success potential of biocontrol, and this is the promise of it. In reality, it doesn't always happen. It is actually difficult to purposefully introduce something and get it to establish. So biocontrol, when it works, it's cost effective, it's sustainable and long term, and it's very highly host selective, as opposed to, say, something like a broad spectrum herbicide. There are some limitations, however. You have to worry about non-target effects. If your host is similar to maybe a threatened and endangered species or an economic value crop, then we might actually have trouble finding an agent to introduce. But there is choice and no choice testing done, lots of environmental assessments. There's quite a bit of regulatory hurdle to get an agent selected to be introduced. We want to make sure that because once you let it go, there's no, it's irreversible unless they don't establish. So you want to make sure you make the right decision. It actually takes about 10 years from the initial scouting of a biocontrol agent to the introduction of an agent into the US. It takes a while, lots of science and regulation. And again, it will not eradicate, and you have to have patience for it. In terms of safety, there's been a couple meta studies that have been done looking at the literature, what information is out there, and both weed biocontrol, very safe, very, very little in terms of non-target effects. The few cases that are out there were introductions that were made a long time ago. And to be honest, there's things that were introduced in the 1960s that wouldn't clear the regulatory hurdles now. We have a different mindset now and different rules, and those things wouldn't get passed through. And similar for arthropod insect biocontrol safety as well. Very little in terms of non-target effects, a lot of safety. And that's due to some really good science and some good regulations. Some other disadvantages of biocontrol is or the, I'm sorry, these are advantages. So I said that host specificity is one of the things when we're looking at weed biocontrol. A lot of insects and the insects that we work with are host specific. So they're not like an omnivore, like a grasshopper that'll eat anything. They have a very tight ecological relationship with their host. And they don't deviate from that very much. And so they seek out that plant to feed on, to lay its eggs on, to reproduce on. And usually it's one species or a host of related species, very related species that they feed on. When it works great, our agents are self-perpetuating. They reproduce, and then they self-disseminate, they spread into new terrain. There's a high benefit to cost ratio. Basically, up front, there's some initial research dollars that need to be spent for that. For that scouting, the selectivity testing, and those kind of things, but once they get established and if they self disseminate, those costs are non-recurrent. Like they don't happen. They will accrue over many, many years. Some of the most successful biocontrol programs that were like St. John's wort was successfully controlled through an insect back in the in rangeland back in the 1960s, and that success continues to this day. Some of the disadvantages, like I said, it does take a while. You have to have some patience, so it's relatively slow acting. Like if you have a if your pest or if your Yeah, if your pest is similar to an important economic plant, threatening endangered, then you might have trouble finding a selective agent for it. It doesn't always work. That high initial investment, sometimes it's hard to put your money into that, the chance that something will work. And then, of course, like I said, it's irreversible. So I think the most important question for biocontrol in terms of implementation is, do we have an effective agent available? And so I highlight the ones that we have that we're currently working on here in the state of Colorado that we have agents available for. This is a list of the agent of the pests, the weeds that we have. And of those, there's a few that there's a couple that are kind of limited in terms of we don't have a whole lot of agents, yellow toad flax and Canada thistle. The yellow toad flax seems to be working, but we're having trouble finding reproducing populations from which we can collect out in the field and redistribute. And then a Canada thistle, I'll talk about a little bit later, and some of the regulatory hurdles of our biocontrol agent for Canada thistle. And thinking about vineyards and what kind of weeds that you have that you potentially have around your properties or in your that interfere with your cultivation. Diffuse and spotted knapweed could be a problem. Musk thistle, puncture vine, Russian knapweed, field bindweed, and Canada thistle. And so we have agents available for those. So I thought I'd highlight and talk about those weeds that we have and give you a little background on how those things, what we have for those. And then potentially coming down the line, or we could potentially get these agents coming in addition to the ones we're already working with. We actually have some of that first one. It's a mite for hoarycress, Asaria drabae for hoarycress, otherwise known as white top. And we're hopefully going to have mites to distribute in the next year or so. We actually have some reproducing populations here in Colorado we're working with. The mite for Russian olive control, we don't want to kill the whole trees. A lot of people find the trees valuable for shade, and there's some birds that utilize it. So the Asaria angustifoliae is a mite that just feeds on the fruit of Russian olive, and so it should reduce the spread of that invasive tree. And then the three bottom ones are ones that actually exist in other places, and they're available to us. We don't particularly work with them in Colorado, but other people can order them, and we'd if you wanted any information on those, you could always ask us as well. So to get into the weeds that we have agents for, both diffuse and spotted knapweed are present, and they are noxious weeds in Colorado. We have a couple of agents that work on those. Basically, if you could look at the map there, the one on the left, diffuse knapweed, we have mostly it's a Front Range problem. There's a lot of it over there, but it is kind of in other spots. And then spotted knapweed is not as prevalent as diffuse knapweed, a little more by this widespread. I would say that La Plata County down there in the southwest is probably the worst spot for spotted knapweed in the state. Very similar plants. They look very similar. They also can hybridize. For diffuse knapweed, these are tumbleweeds, so they're kind of globular forming, and they have bracts and spines, and they both have these two agents that feed on each of them. On the left is our lesser knapweed weevil, Larinus minutus, and it lays its eggs in the seed head, and the larvae carve out the seed head. And that's a very effective agent. It prefers diffuse knapweed over spotted, but will feed on both. And then the knapweed root weevil on the right of the screen, Siphocleones acates, is a root knapweed. It feeds on the roots, the larvae do, and it reduces the flowering and ability of the plant to grow, can kill plants eventually. And it's pretty effective as well, although we don't get very many of those to redistribute, unfortunately. But it's my favorite insect, so I usually throw in a couple of photos of it. It's pretty big. It's actually about the size of a pinto bean, and they're starting to come out right now. I found a few last week. They're August is kind of their month to be out and about. It's kind of camouflaged when it lays on the ground, but I really like it. So those are two effective agents that we have available from CDA. Another weed that we have agents for is musk thistle, also known as nodding thistle. It is a biennial thistle that can really, it kind of likes a little bit wet areas. It can be a problem in cropping systems. We have a fairly effective agent for it. This is a rosette. It's a biennial, so one year it'll have a rosette like this, and then the next year it pushes up a stalk. And this is one I ran into up in the foothills last year. That is a meter stick. So that rosette of musk thistle is a meter wide, and I was just flabbergasted at how big that was. But it can get very big, and can be very weedy. Our agent for this is we call it T. horridus, Trichocera callus horridus. It's a also a root weevil. It feeds right on right in the root crown of the thistle and can kill musk thistle. And we actually have been having trouble collecting this one because what we do to most of these agents that I'm talking about, what we do is we rear them in what we call nursery sites. So we actually go out to field areas and we release them, and then we go back in subsequent years and hope that the population builds up enough that there we can collect them and redistribute them from those areas. But actually, with musk thistle, a lot of our areas where we've tried to use them as nursery sites, they're so effective that they wipe out the musk thistle, and we really have trouble collecting them. So those musk thistle populations have collapsed. So we'll figure it out. We used to have some really good areas that we could collect from all the time, and then they collapsed, and we've had limited T. horridus numbers the last couple of years. But I think that'll turn around. We're working on that. Puncture vine might be something that you get in your orchards or your vineyards. Puncture vine doesn't compete with other plants too well, so that's something to keep in mind. Maybe cover crops. If you have puncture vine problems, cover crops might be a good idea. But we do have a biocontrol for that. That is my boot. I did walk across puncture vine last year. I've worked with puncture vine for 16 years now. I should know better. I forgot. It's pretty bad, also known as goat heads for people. It's the bane of many mountain bikers. It is a Eurasian plant, and it's frequently attacks bicycle tires. Yeah. So we have two weevils that work on puncture vine. We have a seed head feeder and a stem feeder that feeds within the stem. These were originally released in the 1960s, and originally they weren't found north of Amarillo, Texas. And they thought that they were not cold hardy. But then some CDA employees found it down in Baca County in 1978. When I started in 2008, we were collecting puncture vine weevils from down Baca County, Springfield, and Campo, Colorado. But since about 2010, we've actually been able to collect most of our puncture vine weevils from the Denver metro area. So either we have a cold hardy strain, or climate change has changed the. I would say we definitely don't have the deep freeze we used to have. We used to have a couple weeks at a time where it wouldn't get above zero, and that would really do a good number on some pests, but also would kill something like these agents off. Their populations would severely decline. And we just haven't really had that in the last few years. Maybe probably been 20, 30 years since we've really had something like that on a regular basis. Another weed that you may encounter than the other knapweeds I talked about, it is one of our growing problems in the state as a noxious weed. That's over there on the west slope, that big picture. It's invades rangeland, cropland, roadsides. It can survive in a variety of soils. It's a very tough plant. Its strength is in its it grows. It's kind of allelopathic, so it outcompetes other things, and it can spread through the rhizomes, and grows root buds, and it's a very difficult plant to control with herbicides. We do have a couple of agents now that are available for this. These have been introduced in the last. This one was introduced about 10 years ago in 2013 in Colorado. Aulacidia croptilonica. It's a gall-forming wasp. It forms galls in the stem of Russian knapweed. You can see that lower right photo. They're pretty small wasps, not very big. And then our other agent for Russia and Napweed is Japiella ivanikovi, which is a gall midge, and it lays its eggs in the terminal growing end of the Russian Napweed, and that's a gall there that's being shown in that one photo where the a gall, basically, if you don't know, is it's a physiological response of the plant. So that the larva of the insect is growing, and the plant forms this mass of tissue around it that's called a gall. And so within a gall like that, there could be 20 of the midge larvae in there, maybe even more. Here's a photo of Russian knapweed out in the field. On the left, you see the stem has got the Aplysidia galls, and then on the right, you can see the midge galls on the terminal end, the growing end of the plant there. And there was actually a CSU graduate student, Teresa Barosh. She actually did her PhD research on these two, and are two agents better than one? And she did the research because they could be antagonistic. They could compete for resources. They might not do well together in the field, but her research showed that actually they help each other. Once one is established and weakens the plant, the other one actually does well too. And between the two of them, they can really create quite a taxing I was going to go too a little too scientific, a metabolical sink. So basically, the plant has to waste resources defending against making these galls, so it doesn't have as much resources to grow tall and flower. And so hopefully you can introduce that competition effect, and other plants can outcompete Russian knapweed once these agents get established. And then Charlotte was talking about probably the biggest problem that you have in your vineyards would be field bindweed. Field bindweed is a list C noxious weed in Colorado. That means that it's a noxious weed. It's listed, but it's pretty much everywhere, widespread, and it is, and it's the bane of gardeners everywhere as well. It's just really hard plant to control. It's similar to morning glories, extensive creeping roots. The CSU herbarium has a root sample that's, I mean, it's gigantic. It's huge. It's like several feet. The tuber, it's like a tuber, and it's several feet wide and a huge diameter. And they dug it up from inside the ground. So it's just very successful in coming back from its roots, even if you cut it off. The seeds are also viable for a long time, so it can be problems, wide-ranging problems, dry land ag, crops, rangeland everywhere. So our best agent for field bindweed is a microscopic Asaria malarbe. It's a mite. It's a galling mite. So on the left there are the little tiny microscopic mites that you see. And then the middle, the upper right is the electron microscope of what a mite looks like up close. And then the middle photo there shows what happens when the mite is feeding on the plant and it's forming galls there. Those are bindweed leaves that are folded up and deformed because of the mite feeding. Basically, that midrib of the vine, the first thing you would see, the first indication that the mites have successfully established is the leaf folds up and the midrib gets bumpy. Basically, the mites overwinter in the roots. So they in like late August, early September, they start migrating their way to the roots. And I have seen over in Grand Junction plants that are gnarled that barely come out of the ground. Because of the galling that mites can cause. Here's some other mites that can really get kind of big mites or big galls, I'm sorry, forming where the mites are. Oh, I was gonna, one more thing about, so in terms of vineyard stuff, anybody that works with these mites, this is not one of the ones that we can just set and forget. They're probably good. They will spread on their own through wind and water. I would say to successfully use mites for field bindweed biocontrol, you'd have to actually kind of cultivate the mites. So put them on an area where you can watch for gall formation, and then trim the vines back so that they don't go to seed, and take them and manually move them from your infested material to other non-infested material. So you almost have to kind of cultivate the mites and move them around yourself. And they do take some intervention post-release. And I think one of the limiting factors for this is they are microscopic. So you have to look for those signs of gall formation. And it does take some time for them to get established and move. So the other thing that I think might happen, they seem to work better in drier conditions when the field bindweed has a lot of water. It seems to grow and can kind of slough off any of the galls. I mean, in terms of like the mite doesn't seem to affect well-watered bindweed. So it might take some effort to see if they work in a vineyard or not. But I think it might be worth a shot, especially if you have difficulty with herbicides and your vineyard controlling bindweed. And then Canada thistle is probably one of the worst weeds around the world. We have a rust fungus, Puccinia punctiformis, that we started working with about 10 years ago. It's a very effective agent. It was the first plant pathogen suggested for a biocontrol agent way back in 1893. We've kind of figured out how to work with it in the state. Unfortunately, about 2 years ago, somebody in the EPA decided that they wanted to be the they decided the EPA was the regulatory authority over pathogens, weed biocontrol pathogens. The USDA had been regulating them, and so currently there's some discussions going on between the EPA and the USDA at the federal level to basically, I think the USDA would like to get back the regulatory control of this rust fungus along with some others. So we're kind of in a holding pattern. We do have a research permit to work with this, but right now it's on hold. I think eventually we will get to use it again. It's a very effective agent for controlling Canada thistle. And if you would, you might actually even have it because a lot, Canada thistle rust fungus is already in a lot of places. We certainly introduced it over the about the 8 years that the USDA regulated it. We had the ability to. We spread it around quite a bit. On the left is a field with some Canada thistle in it, and the plants that look sort of like they're not quite as green. They're a little bit yellowing. Those are the plants with the rust fungus in it, and that's in the springtime when the Canada thistle is just coming up. That's the easiest time to see it. It also the spore type in the springtime is called a spermogonia, and it's very fragrant. It smells like a flower. It's actually really a pleasant smell, it's pretty distinctive. So up close, the plant looks very, very chlorotic. Basically. And then on the right is what the spore forms look like in the middle of the summer. Those are aceospores, and that's where it gets the rust fungus name from that rusty red color of the spores. So for any of those biocontrols, you can call the Palisade Insectary. We have a toll-free number there. You can also just Google Palisade Insectary, and it'll take you to our website. And if you are a municipality, an institution, another agency, a state agency, or county or city, you can or get. We have a subscription program available to you. You can inquire about that as well. And then when you get one of our agents, when you buy them, you get we overnight them with FedEx, and you get some release instructions. It'll talk about how to release the agents, how to care for them, what to look for their establishment, and see how they're performing. So you kind of have some idea of what to look for. And then so you how to what to look for then the following year after release. And then we usually actually ask for data from people. So we ask people to return data sheets and the cooler that we ship them in if you can. For environmental reasons. And that's kind of the weed biocontrol. And then I threw a little bit of Japanese beetle biocontrol on here, Just a brief mention. So Japanese beetle was first introduced into the US in the 1920s. It's been spreading its way across the US. Eventually, it'll probably be everywhere, but it had been kind of held in check through regulation for a long time, but eventually it kind of breaks through. It's been over on the Front Range for over 20 years now, building populations. There has been an internal quarantine for Japanese beetle instituted by the Colorado Department of Ag to try and methods of moving Japanese beetle over to the West Slope. Unfortunately, there seems to be a fairly large population or a detectable level in Grand Junction currently. And there was a Japanese beetle, you may know, found in the early 2000s in Palisade, and that was successfully eradicated. That was the numbers of Japanese beetle found during that project, and the small geographic scope of that project made it pretty successful. There's a few other places where larger eradication efforts have taken place. Utah, California, Washington, Oregon have all successfully eradicated it at one time or another, but it took a lot of money and time. And then eventually, I think Oregon has had reintroductions of Japanese beetle, and so they're struggling to try and kind of keep it down. It loves to eat lots of different plants, 300 different species. The adults do anyway. The grub, it's a C-shaped grub. It's a scarab beetle, and the grub feeds on turf mostly. So they have different host requirements. Currently, here's a good map of sort of CDA map of where we have a very good trap and lure for Japanese beetles, so we're pretty confident when we put those out. And we say we can't find it in those areas. We're pretty confident we don't have Japanese beetle there. The red areas are the areas where there's definitely high and reproducing populations. It spread from the South Metro Denver area was the first place, but now we have very large populations all across the South Denver metro area, and now the Northeast. Boulder has a fairly large and growing population, and then Pueblo around the all over Pueblo actually pretty much, but around the city zoo and everything. And then, of course, there's low-level populations are green, and we found a few there, and that's where I would classify the current Japanese beetle level over in Grand Junction. So there are a few natural enemies of Japanese beetle. The ones that the milky spore and the nematodes, they haven't worked so well in Colorado. They've been tested. We don't really have that well. We don't have enough humidity, basically, I think, for those things to work well. These three agents are ones that have been recently introduced into Colorado. Ovovesicula papilliae is a microsporidian disease. Typhia vernalis is a parasitic wasp. And Ishtakita aldrichi is a parasitic fly. So I've introduced, and Dr. Whitney Cranshaw with Colorado State University, both of us have worked to introduce these agents into the state. Of the three agents, I think that the Ishtakita might be established. We found some last year. I haven't confirmed that we found some this year, but if I find some this year, I'll feel like we maybe got it established. It might be a while before we have big enough populations that we can collect and redistribute. And then Typhia vernalis, we have not recovered any as far as I know yet. But I think the best agent for biocontrol of Japanese beetle right now is this microsporidian disease. It's basically species specific. It gets into their digestive system. It reduces the number of eggs a female can lay, and it does kill or inhibits the ability of the larva of Japanese beetle to overwinter. In some studies in Michigan, it showed a big reduction. So these are the Malpighian tubules. This is the digestive system of insects, basically, and that gets these spores in them. And that's one way to detect them. There's also now a molecular method to detect them, which is easier than the dissection. So we're actually a little hopeful that we can utilize that technology and get a real good idea of where it's spread. And Dr. Cranshaw successfully introduced the Microsporidian ovovesicula from Michigan, and he has also successfully moved it from some spots, I believe, in the Denver metro area, or actually Boulder to other places. So proof of concept, it works. And then in Michigan, they showed like a 75% decline in a Japanese beetle population. So it won't eradicate them, but it'll reduce the overall population, which would be the goal of biocontrol. These are the places where the red dots are where Ovovesicula has been released, and the purple dots, it's also been released there, but also now it's been detected. So we do have some of that Microsporidian disease around, and it's probably the most promising biocontrol agent we have for Japanese beetle right now. Yeah, a study out of Michigan showed at least 76.5% of the larvae infected with this died over the winter. So if we can get it out there and get it established, I think it'll be do a good job of reducing the overall population of Japanese beetle. Yeah, so we haven't quite measured the effectiveness, but that's a goal of ours, would be to actually measure the population effects of that disease. Yeah, so I thank you for your time. I really enjoyed giving up talking about what I do. I like to do the science of biocontrol, and I really like enjoy public outreach as well. If you have any questions, let me know.
All right, if anybody has any questions, now would be the time to unmute yourself or drop it in the chat box. It's pretty much free rein, so I'll let you guys start off some questions. I'll hold mine for a little bit. Well, or maybe I'll kick it off. So, are there any insecticides that we should actively avoid if we're trying to encourage any of these releases to survive?
Unfortunately, a lot of our beneficial insects are very vulnerable to pesticides. I don't have exact, if a lot of people ask what they would do, and basically, in terms of like a weed biocontrol agent, you kind of have to leave at least some of the weed undisturbed because that's what they need to eat. And herbicides aren't necessarily harmful to insects directly. It's not a very good answer to your question. The couple areas that I know, I think that where we've measured things that they our beneficial insects are certainly susceptible to a lot of different insecticides. But herbicides, that's just maybe a matter of leaving the host plant available for at least some population. I'll give you an example. We have somebody that did diffuse knapweed biocontrol with the Larinus minutus seed head feeding weevil down in Larkspur for years. And then they got it under control and they decided, hey, we're going to spray herbicide. And they wiped out all their knapweed with herbicide. And then the knapweed came back with a vengeance. And what they realized was that they needed to leave a little refuge of knapweed with weevils on it. And that kept their knapweed at bay. And they so they're believers now, and it takes a while. Yeah.
So we did have a question pop up in the box, and I might actually take that one for you.
Yeah,
Any
go
risk
ahead.
to grapevines with granular pre-emergent weed products like Scotts to control dandelions? So it really depends on the time of year. So your pre-emergent for these specific products, if any of the vines are starting to break bud, then yes. So a lot of these pre-emergents require water to soak them down into the ground to get them into those plants themselves. And in that process, you're getting them down into the roots around your grapevines. And grapes are incredibly susceptible to anything that is systemic. I mean, absolutely anything. They are a fantastic little indicator plant if you want to see how far an herbicide has moved. It will curl up in a heartbeat. So if you can get your pre-emergent on and be outside the range of standard activity before your vines start breaking bud, you're fine. But usually, when our vines are starting to wake up, that's when our dandelions and things are starting to wake up as well. So it gets kind of touch and go. And I get very nervous. We actually have a bit of a problem with herbicide drift all over the Grand Valley just because we have a lot of hay fields and applications to control weeds in hay fields. So. Any other questions out there, guys? Do you know how much these insects cost? Like how many
Oh,
bucks are you
yeah,
seeing at
I
a time?
didn't put that in there. The field bindweed mites are $35 per release, and all our other agents, insect agents, are $30 per release. And then our Canada thistle rust fungus, when we used to sell it, was $50 a release, but we've stopped selling it because of the regulatory concerns right now. But hopefully we'll be able to reintroduce that one.
Is there a minimum number of releases per an area? So like an acre needs one release, more
Yeah,
needs.
that's kind of our rule of thumb. But with demand for some of these are really high, and actually the ability of our ability to collect and redistribute them. So for some things, we have to limit it to one or two releases for people. We don't have, one of the things you can do is order a release once per year for like 3 years, and so like sequentially release it over a couple of years. That's one of the things that we advise. So.
Okay. I have one other question that's kind of in this vein of things. Oh, I just lost it. I got distracted. Anyway, I'm going to answer the question in the chat real quick. I'm kind of hoping other people will chime in with more questions. A vine that is affected by herbicide drift will still produce viable or non-toxic fruit. It really depends on the level of drift, like a little bit of drift that just gets the tops of your vines. You might be okay. Personally, my rule of thumb is I don't want to eat it if it's been impacted by herbicides. And a lot of times it'll actually abort the fruit if it was hit early in the season. So the bigger problem is once you start getting into the fruit abortion, you also start getting into impacts with vine longevity. So if a vine was hit hard enough to actually lose fruit, it may or may not come back strongly the next year. And it can have a building effect depending on the herbicide. So not a straightforward answer. I personally don't feel comfortable eating fruit off of a vine that's been hit by herbicide. But anybody else have any questions? Oh, any information on foxtails, or do you guys have any plans for foxtail control?
I have never, I don't know of anything. I haven't heard anything for it. I get asked, there's a few weeds out there that I get asked about, cheatgrass a lot. Unfortunately, we don't have anything good for those yet.
That would be amazing if there was.
Yeah.
Any other questions, guys? We've still got a few more minutes. Well, if not, I can give you back a few more minutes of your day. This was really informative and kind of exciting. I'm really happy to hear that we actually have some opportunities to do things like this in the state and that they've actually been established. So, if there aren't any more questions, thank you all for attending. This has been really great to see you all on Zoom again. And oh,
Yeah,
about
and
kochia.
I would add one more thing. Oh, kochia, I'm sorry. Yeah, we don't have anything for kochia either, and unfortunately, that's a big deal because it's of the herbicide resistance that it's showing a lot. If you are for field bindweed, if you're interested, I'm not the program manager. Nina Loudon is, but I could get you in touch with her, and I'm sure she would be interested in doing some little test plots or research trials to help you get established mites in grape vineyards, if you had anybody that was interested in that.
I may be contacting you about that because I have a research block that might be a good location for that.
Okay, I would say the same for puncture vine as well, or actually any of our agents.
It's
If you can always
anything
contact
you
them.
can imagine is in that vineyard and not in
Okay.
quantities that are sustainable. So,
Yeah, okay. Sounds good.
if you guys don't have any more questions, I will give you back 8 minutes of your time and it's great to see you guys on Zoom. If John, you would stay on for a few more
Sure.
seconds.
Sure. Thank you.
Yay.